to that's deceased. And so I love children. And so that's why I was so hurt by this. Even though it wasn't my child, I still was hurt by this, to see little babies being slaughtered. And if anybody else wasn't hurt, then I don't know. I challenged their relationship with God. Now, today, we're yet dealing with spiritual gifts, amen? And like Minister King just said, as a matter of fact, that's our local attorney, Attorney Jaiway King. And we appreciate him for his faithfulness. We appreciate him just for coming, allowing God to use him and speak to you all. And this is a young man that I've been knowing all of his life. And that's his mother, for all of y'all that may not know it. She the one that be on here with me periodically, praying the closing prayer. And so I don't know whether she's going to be on here today or not. But anyway, let's get to what we come here to talk about today. We're yet talking about pastors. Now, we wanted to close this out last week. But what I want to do now, I want to encourage the pastors out there. Because the Bible talks about in the last days, they will not endure sound doctrine. And what I want to say to all the pastors out there, you continue teaching and preaching apostolic truth and Pentecostal doctrine. You see what I'm saying? You continue. Because people's soul at stake, your soul at stake. Because we're going to have to give an answer to God, to how we teach his people, how we lead his people. Amen? And I feel as though if a preacher cannot speak out against injustice, he just a minister and figurehead only. Now, I think Minister King left off with, I will give you paths according to my heart, which shall feed you with knowledge and with understanding. See, the Bible tells us that wisdom is the principal thing. Are you with me? The Bible said, with all you're getting, get what? Get understanding. The Bible also tells us that knowledge is too high for a fool. Anybody that do not want to retain God in their members, in their mind, in their thoughts, don't want to hear nothing about the word of God. Reject sound teaching, sound preaching, then it's definitely something wrong with you. The Bible says, if any man would like wisdom, let him pray and ask of God. God will give it to him liberally, upbraid it not. So God said, if you want wisdom, I'll give it to you with no strings attached. And so that's what we are out here teaching, preaching, talking about the word of God. Because the scriptures say, know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. But the only truth going to make you free is the truth that you apply to your life. You have a lot of people hear the truth, but resist the truth. What is truth? The Bible said, thy word is truth. And so these are the kind of things that will keep me up all night. I'm talking about the word of God. Because to me, there's nothing more important than winning souls. See, a lot of people looking for the big building, they're looking for the multitude of people. Thank God, Sister Claire Franklin, we send love all the way to Fort Worth, Texas. God bless you. And I don't have a problem with that. But the fact of the matter is, it's more to being a pastor than have a large congregation. I say this, and I say it out of the sincerity of my heart. I would rather have a church with a small membership with people that save than have a large membership with people that are not saved. When you're not concerned about people's souls, when that is not priority, because it's not priority to you, you concerned more about what they think or what they feel than what God says. I'm more concerned about what God says. I'm more concerned about answering to God. Are y'all with me? Because one day we all will have to answer to God. We need to realize this. One day we all are going to answer to God. And so I just want to welcome you to our Pentecostal apostolic holiness, Holy Ghost feel, hour of wisdom, knowledge, and understanding. What we're all about, edifying the body of Christ, providing both moral and intellectual instruction. We also is here to educate you. That is to bring forth, to bring out the potential that God put inside of you, that you could be the leader that God is calling for in this last hour. We're also on here to empower you. That's right, I'm talking to you. We're on here to empower you, to make you stronger and more confident, especially in controlling your life and claiming your rights as a child of God. So don't forget, like, tag, and share. Let everybody know. One of the last of your school prophet on the air, teaching, preaching the unadulterated word of God, not for the love of money, not for fame or for glory, but that God will be glorified. The saints will be edified. Satan will be horrified and terrified. Backslider will be restored. Sinners be saved and delivered. Like, tag, and share, and let everybody know it's time for upgrade. God want to upgrade us in every area of our life. And when I'm talking about an upgrade, God want to upgrade us spiritually. He want to establish a closer relationship between him and us. God want to upgrade you physically. God want to heal your body. God, he want to upgrade your finances. The Bible say, above all things, I wish that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as your soul shall prosper. So God want to upgrade you in every area of your life, mentally, emotionally, spiritually, physically, financially. I say God want to upgrade you. And now, this is the year. This is the hour. This is the season. And this is the time for the upgrade. Because 2022 is the year of the manifestation of your expectation. A lot of things you've been praying about, a lot of things you've been crying out to God. Thank God for Sister Coleman and thank God for Sister Ashley. God bless you. We send a shout out to Sister Ashley. Her surgery went well. Amen. So I appreciate God for that. And so a lot of times we don't realize that some of the things that we've been praying about and seeking God about, and we thought that God was not going to do it. We thought that God did not hear us. I come to tell you that this year, 2022, is the year of the manifestation of your expectation, the thing that you've been praying about, the thing that you've been on your face about, the thing that you've been crying out to God about. This is your year. Thank God for Mother Keller coming on, just had knee surgery, 2 knee replacements. She was bold. She got them both done at the same time. I don't know if I could have been quite that bold, but she's doing well. And we send our condolences out to Sister Danielle Keller, who lost her husband. And so we send condolences to the family. The Keller family, the Coleman family, we send condolences to you. All right, let's get back to this message. Brother Jahwe left off with Jeremiah 3:15. Where the Bible says, I give you a pastor according to my own heart that can feed you with knowledge and with understanding. Thank God for Sister Eugenia for coming on. Now, the Bible lets us know that God married to the backslider. A lot of time when people get out of the will of God, because of pride, pride hinders them from getting their souls right with God. So that's what my purpose I want to encourage backsliders to come back. I want to encourage sinners to get saved. And I want to encourage the saints to be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Now, listen to me. Let me repeat myself one more time. The reason why I'm on here to try to win souls to the kingdom, to get sinners saved, backsliders restored, and the saints strengthened, and to spread this gospel. Now, when the scripture says, I give you pastor according to my own heart, shall feed you with knowledge and understanding. What we're dealing with today, we're dealing with the spiritual gift, right? And one of the spiritual gifts that we was on last week and we're dealing with it this week is the gift of pastor. That's a gift. The Bible say he led captivity captain. What did he do? He gave gifts unto men. So I don't know if that's your gift or not. But if that is your gift, I'm here with everything inside of me to encourage you. Be bold. Don't take down. Don't back up. Don't quit. Thank God for Sister Dunn coming on. Are y'all with me? Because the Bible says Satan walking around seeking whom he may devour. Thank God for Deacon Williams coming on. As a roaring lion, he's walking about seeking whom he may devour. But I looked in the book. The book said that Jesus is the lion of the tribe of Judah. Satan have no power over you. Satan have no authority over you. As a matter of fact, when Satan see you coming, he should be trembling, just like when he saw Paul. When the vagabond Jews that had no authority, all they were imitators. When they say, I adjure thee by the Jesus whom Paul preached, that tell me that they didn't really know anything about Jesus. They didn't know that he was omnipotent, had all power. They didn't know that he was omniscient, ever learning, know all things. They didn't know that he was omnipresent, everywhere at the same time. They did not know that he was immutable. He does not change. What he did for somebody else, he'll do the same thing for you. Because God is just bad like that. I serve an awesome God. Now, so when those vagabond Jews, when they applied the name of Jesus, remember in the 10th chapter of the book of Luke, in the 10th chapter, I think, of the book of Matthew, if I remember correctly. But in the book of Luke, the Bible say, I need y'all to get this, even the devils are subject to us through your name. See, healing, deliverance, miracle working power, deliverance, it all comes through the name of Jesus. Thank God for Deacon Wallace coming on. God bless you, Deacon. Are y'all with me? Now, so because they applied the name, the demons are subject to the name. But they had no Holy Ghost. They had not been legally put in a position to apply the name because they hadn't yet been baptized in the name of Jesus. So they were operating illegally. So we have a lot of preachers out there operating, but they're operating illegally. I just said something. Because unless you've taken on the name of Jesus, the Bible said men were baptized into him and put him on. Thank God for Sister Jackson coming on. So if you had not yet been baptized in his name, you hadn't yet put him on. So you do not have the power of turning. You do not have the power and the authority to use the name legally. You can use the name like the Vagabond Jews, but you're using it illegally. But the power, the authority is in the name. So now in the 10th chapter of the book of Luke, the Bible says the Lord told him, I give unto you power to tread on scorpions and serpents, all the power of the enemy, and nothing by any means shall be able to hurt you. This word power comes from azuzia. And this word means authority. So when I took on the name of Jesus in water baptism, I got the authority to act on his behalf. But I didn't just stop there because I got filled with the gift of the Holy Ghost with evidence of speaking in other tongues. So now I have azuzia power because I took on his name in baptism, but now I have dunamis power, miracle working power, because I'm filled with the gift of the Holy Ghost. So come on, preacher, stand. People may walk out on you, but stand. People may cast stones on you, but stand. People may forsake you, but stand. Stand up for righteousness, stand up for holiness, preach the gospel. In season, out of season, when they want to hear it, when they don't want to hear it, when they close their ears, when they clap, when they don't clap, when they look, when they don't look, preach the word and be bold. Now, let's go to 1 Timothy chapter 3. We're talking to pastors, and I want to encourage all the pastors. Chapter 3, verse 1. This is a true saying, if a man desired the office of a bishop, he desired a good work. A bishop must be blameless, husband of one wife, vigilant, sober, of good behavior, given to hospitality, apt to teach, not given to wine, no striker, not greedy or filthy lucre, but patient, not a brawler, but covetous, not covetous. One that ruleth well his own house, having his children in subjection with all gravity. I need y'all to catch this. For if a man know not how to rule his own house, how shall he take care of the church of God? Paul was instructing Timothy. Timothy, I want you to understand that that before you ordain elders and bishops and appoint people to different offices, let me give you the criteria they must reach in order to be in a position. See, because now people put people in office because of popularity. You look like a preacher. Your daddy was a preacher. You got a head made like a preacher. You sing like a preacher. But now Paul laid this thing out. My God. We're reading 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse number 5. Let me read that one again. For if a man know not how to rule his own house, how shall he take care of the church of God? Not a novice, lest being lifted up with pride, he fall in the condemnation of the devil. Moreover, he must have a good report of them which are without, lest he fall into the reproach and snare of the devil. That's powerful. That is powerful. Paul says so many awesome things in this particular chapter. But I like the way he instructs Timothy. In other words, Timothy, don't compromise. I don't think y'all caught that. Don't compromise, Timothy. When you start setting people up in offices, anointing people, ordaining people for offices, don't compromise. Are you with me? Now, let me read these same verses as I take my time and do an exegesis of this text. Dealing with pastors. Thank God for Deacon Lewis coming on. I want to read this to you out of the Living Bible. 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 1. Please write these scriptures down. Go back, study these scriptures in your devotional time. Because I want you to be able to say what the Lord said, not what my bishop said, not what my pastor said, but what the Lord said. 1 Timothy 3:1 out the Living Bible is the truth saying that if a man wants to be a pastor, he has a good ambition. So there's nothing wrong with you wanting to be a pastor. But Paul tell Timothy here, the criteria you must reach in order to be a pastor. Are y'all with me? Thank God for Sister Catherine Thompson, I think. God bless you. We appreciate you for being on here with us. Now, this is so important. Because we know a lot of people that carry the title. We know a lot of people that have a turn back collar on. We know a lot of people that been licensed through the judicial system. We know a lot of people that have degrees on top of degrees in theology. Are you listening to me? And none of that I have a problem with. But my question is, do you meet the criteria what God said you ought to be a pastor? Now, 1 Timothy 3:2. For a pastor must be a good man whose life cannot be spoken against. Now, excuse me. Years ago, before God saved me, I couldn't say that because I was tore up on the floor. But after God saved me and filled me with the Holy Ghost and appointed and ordained me for this position, I don't take down. And I try to help people. I try to be an example to society. I can guarantee you can walk through my neighborhood and ask people about me since I was saved. And I can guarantee you, you won't find hardly none that will say anything negative. And the one that you do, they must be haters. Come on. The Bible says your life is supposed to be hid in Christ. I try to live that kind of way. Understand what I'm saying. Catch this. For a pastor must be a good man whose life cannot be spoken against. He must have only one wife. I don't see what a man could do with two anyway. That's ludicrous. He must have only one wife. He must be hardworking and thoughtful. Well, I've been working for just retired last year after 43 years working in one place. 35 years, 36, I think now. Pastoring one church. Another 15, 20 years pastoring a second church. Come on. While at the same time I was working. So don't tell me that I'm not a hardworking man. But I'm not talking about myself today. I want y'all to meet the criteria that Paul gave to Timothy before he appointed elders and bishops and pastors. He must be thoughtful, orderly, full of good deeds. He must enjoy having guests in his house and must be a good Bible teacher. I'll let you judge that. Because a lot of y'all be on here with me every day. So I'll let you judge that. I don't mind having guests in my house. I try my best to be a good Bible teacher. Come on. So if anybody come up with accusations, whether I'm full of good deeds, y'all look at the many people that I gave vehicles to. Look at the people I gave money to. And some of them, I never got it back. Are you with me? Some I gave to, some I loaned to. Some of them I loaned to, didn't bring it back, so I might as well gave it to them. Are you with me? Catch this, verse 3, 1 Timothy 3:3, reading out the Living Bible. He must not be a drinker or quarrelsome, but he must be gentle and kind. And not be one who loves money. If I love money so much, I wouldn't be giving so much of it away. Come on. The Bible says you can't be a drinker. You can't be quarrelsome. Every little thing, get on your nerve. Every little thing, you want to start a fight. The Bible says you must be gentle and kind. One sister, she told me, say, she called me the gentle giant, I think. She said, when people see you, you're always so meek and humble. Said, well, give you a mic and put you behind a pulpit, you're a different person. Now, in my nature, it's just my nature to be humble, but don't get that twisted. I'm humble, but I'm not a wimp. A lot of people that are taking advantage of me because of the love that I have for people. But don't get that twisted. God has made me bold enough to not be afraid of people's faces. And that's what I want to encourage all the pastors out there today. Don't be afraid of their faces, Pastor. Some of them are going to be smiling. Some of them are going to be frowning. Some of them, if you don't watch them, they'll be on their phone texting. Why are you on the floor preaching? But I'm here to encourage you. Don't be discouraged. Hold on. What else they say about pastors? Must not be one that love money. And you know, I don't like to be critical of other pastors and stuff. Thank God for Sister Irene Walker coming on. God bless you, my sister. I don't like to be critical of other pastors because I'm not the one that do the calling. God is the one that does the calling. Are you with me? But I am passionate about truth. Because the Bible says, warn Israel. And if they don't take heed, the blood will be required at their hand. But if I don't warn them, the blood will be required at my hand. So I'm not worried about people getting upset. I'm not worried about trying to please people. What I want to do is please God. Are you listening to me? So I'm not one of your ear tickler. I'm not going to tell you what you want to hear. I'm not everybody's cup of tea. Are you listening to me? Thank God for Evangelist Nicole, Marcedale. Excuse me, Evangelist, if I mispronounce your name. Charge it to my head, not to my heart. So I don't believe in it just saying stuff to get along with folks. I don't believe in saying what people want me to hear, what they want to hear, so I can get their money. Are you with me? I'm not about that. I'm all about soul. Did y'all get that? And that's what I want to encourage all the pastors out there. It's about soul. It's not about your popularity. It's not about your Lexus, your Mercedes, your Cadillac. It's not about that. It's all about winning souls to the kingdom. Thank God for Sister Cardell coming on. Now, and so, 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse number 2. I'm sorry, verse number 3. I apologize. Verse number 3. The Bible says he must not be a drinker or quarrelsome, but he must be gentle and kind and not be one who loves money. Verse number 4. He must have a well-behaved family. Whoa, wait a minute. Have you ever seen individuals that's in the pulpit have no control over their children? Have you ever seen pastors up preaching and teaching and their wife is totally ignoring the word? The Bible says you must have a well-behaved family with children who obey quickly and quietly. That's powerful. Not only obey, but obey quickly and quietly. We was at a restaurant some years ago. I had my six kids plus my niece, me and my wife. It was nine of us sitting down to the table, eating. And I noticed this elderly Caucasian couple a few tables away from us. And she looked at us, she pointed at our table. Her husband looked over there. He talked to her a little while. They point over to the table again. Then they got up and headed to the table where we were seated. And I told my wife, I said, them people that have been over there pointing at us, they're coming over here now. And a lot of times you think people thinking negative stuff. But this elderly couple walked up to our table and asked a question. Are all of these y'all children? I say, six of them are one of my niece. She said, I was talking to my husband. We just had to come and tell you how great a job that y'all are doing with these children. We just admire y'all. She said, me and my husband only had two children, and we couldn't even much do nothing with them when they went out in the public. They were cut up. She said, but if seven children sitting at this table, you don't see a lot of walking, you don't see a whole lot of talking. And it seemed like these kids are subject unto you all. Thank God for Sister Golden coming on. Now, here is the thing. The thing is, we're one that like to talk. But anytime I thought that she had said enough, I didn't have to fuss, wasn't going to cuss, didn't have to threaten her. All I had to do was look. And that was a certain look that she knew that did not please her daddy. And so she was going to calm right down. But a lot of preachers, a lot of pastors, their children give them word for word. Come on. The Bible say, 1 Timothy 3 and 4, pastor must have a well-behaved family with children who obey quickly and quietly. Not only you ought to obey quickly, but quietly. My baby, 44 years old right now. 34, excuse me. My oldest daughter, 44 right now. My baby, 34. I've never seen, not one time, that any of them ever disrespected me or my wife. Come on. Now. So the Bible says pastor must have a well-behaved family with children who obey quickly and quietly. Are you with me? Now, verse number 5. Say, for if a man can't make his own family behave, how can he help the whole church? That's a good question. If you don't have your family under subjection, how in the world you gonna be able to handle the house of God? Verse number 6. The pastor must not be a new Christian. You ever seen people get saved today, buy a briefcase tomorrow, pass the day after tomorrow? The Bible says a pastor must not be a new Christian, because he might be proud of being chosen so soon. And pride comes before fall. Satan's downfall is an example. So you can't be a new convert. I know people come straight out the streets and go to pasture. Excuse me. But according to what Paul told Timothy, it should not happen like that. Now, verse number 7. Also, he must be well spoken of by people outside the church. I had a pretty good reputation when I before I got in the church. Are you with me? I mean, I did what sinners do. But while doing what sinners did, I yet had a pretty good reputation, especially among older people. Because I tried to make sure that older people didn't know. At that time, I was full of the devil. So now, he must be well spoken of by people outside the church, those who aren't Christians. So you ought to have a good name in the church, good name in your neighborhood, good name on your job, good name in your community. People ought to have good things to say about you if you're a pastor. Now, oh God, excuse me. He must be well spoken of, verse number 7, of people outside the church, those who aren't Christians, so that Satan can't trap him with many accusations and leave him without freedom to lead his flock. I told my son, I said, son, let me explain something to you. Don't tarnish my name. See, because you know, when young ladies get married, they take, for the most part, they take on the name of their husband. But the sons normally keep the name of their dad. So I told my son, I said, son, don't ruin my name. I spent too long working too hard to get this name. And I don't want somebody to come along and just ruin it. So parents, that's the mentality that you ought to have when it comes to your children. Don't allow them to ruin your name. By the grace of God, by the grace of God, and by the mercy of God, never had to been to the jail for one of my children. Never had to post in the bail or bond. Come on. Oh, Lord. That's right. I'm kind of sleepy. Kind of sleepy, kind of hoarse, throat kind of scratchy. So, when Paul was talking to Timothy, giving him instructions, Paul covered just about everything you can cover when it comes down to being a pastor. Verse number 7, 1 Timothy chapter 3. Out of the Living Bible. Thank God, Sister Chantel Davis coming on. Also, it must be well spoken of by people outside the church, talking about the pastors. Are you with me? Those who aren't Christians, so that Satan can't trap him with many accusations and leave him without freedom to lead his flock. So take advantage of the pastor. God called you to be a leader of your flock. Can't be a wimp. You can't be a jellyback when you embrace the pulpit. When you step behind that sacred desk, you are obligated to preach the truth to the people. Because the Bible said in the beginning with the word with God and the word was God. So when you speak the word, that's God talking. Excuse me, I got up early this morning. I was up late last night and got up early this morning. So now, that's the word what I want to put out there, that we need to undergird our pastors. We need to pray for them. I told y'all another day, your pastor ought to be the first person you pray for. I didn't just say the Bible said that, I said that. Because the Bible says, watch out for your soul. There's nothing else that's in your power or possession more important than your soul. So you ought to be praying that God constantly feeds your pastor where he can feed you. Don't get mad with the word. The Bible says eat the whole roll. Let me go a little bit further. Oh, God. Y'all pray for me. I only have about 9 more minutes. Pray for me. Because I got up this morning running. And now luggage trying to catch up with me. But I'm going to be all right till I finish this. The Holy Spirit gives the gift of pastor to some in the church. Catch this. Not to everybody. Everybody can't be the pastor. Just like if all you had were feet, you would not be able to talk. You wouldn't have no hands to do anything with. So God put different gifts in the church. So if you're not a pastor, stay in your lane. The Bible said, rebuke not an elder except in the presence of 2 or 3 witnesses. And then you must make sure that the witnesses that you stand in front of are authentic, are real. Check to see if the advantage is going to be here for prayer. Now, you can leave it open. Thank God for Brother Turner coming on. Now, why is this so important? Because we as shepherds, we as overseers, we as pastors, we as bishops, we have the most awesome responsibility in the world to be a servant to the people, to be a servant to God at the same time. So the Holy Spirit gives us spiritual gift of pastor to some in the church to humbly teach them, guide them, protect them, and to lead them in the mission that God has for his church. That is so important. That is so important. Now, the pastor loved the gospel of Jesus Christ and put it at the center of his life and his ministry. If you don't love the gospel, if you don't love people, then you need to resign from your post and go back and repent. And say, I was just playing. I was just pretending, because people's souls at stake. Stand tall, stand strong, stand firm on the word of God. Now, pastors do not seek fame or recognition for themselves, but they're placed in a position of authority by the Holy Spirit. So ultimately, I will have to give an answer for the souls that under my authority or leadership. So I have to make sure I feed the flock of God with the word, the unadulterated word. Because if I add to this word, God said, I add the plagues that are written in the book. If I take away from this word, God said, I take away your part out of the book of life. Excuse me. Are y'all with me? Now, let me read this to you again. Pastors do not seek fame or recognition for themselves, but they're placed in a position by the authority of the Holy Spirit. The role of a pastor is one of humility and service, as he's reminded daily of his overwhelming need for God's grace for the task at hand. That's why we always got to seek the grace of God. Because we have people's souls in our grasp by what we're teaching and preaching. So make sure when we're teaching and preaching, we're preaching the word. We're not adding to it. We're not taking away from it. But preach that word. Now, let me go just a little bit further. When we go to the book of Titus, chapter 1, Titus chapter 1, give me a minute, let me pull this up. Oh, God help me. I want to start at verse number 6. I better back up a little bit, Father. I was going to start at verse number 5. We'll pick this up on tomorrow. Amen. Thank God for the advantage that has made her arrival. Y'all enjoyed her son in prayer this morning, teaching this morning. And now we're going to close it out. Pastor Sol is a holy friend. Amen. God bless you, all my Kenyan brothers. God bless all of y'all that's on your with us by live streaming. Thank God for Pastor Lovey Hunter coming on. Pastor Hunter, amen. When you get a chance, give me a call. I misplaced your phone number, but give me a call because I have some things I want to talk to you about. And Pastor Hunter just came out of Kenya, and they are trying to get me to come to Kenya. I ran into the hands of evangelist Deborah Jean King.
Hello, everyone. How y'all doing out there? Hopefully, and pray all is well on today. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord, Pastor Silas. How are you doing on today? Hopefully, and pray all is well in Africa. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. God, we come today repenting for everything in us, God, that's not like you. We ask you even now, God, that you would destroy at the root the very core and cause of it. Create within me, God, a clean heart, renew within me a right spirit, that my prayers would not only be heard, God, but they would be answered. I thank you, Lord God, for being a keeper of my mind, my body, my soul. I thank you for life, health, and strength. I thank you, Lord God, for our leaders on today. I ask you, Lord God, to continue to bless them, keep them, meet every need in their lives, oh God. I thank you, Lord God, for all the leaders that's out there listening, Lord God. You know what they're standing in need on today, Lord God. I ask you to do it for them even now, God. And those that have not walked into the truth, God, I ask you even now that you will open up their understanding. Give them wisdom. Give them knowledge. Give them understanding of your word, Lord God, that they will be able to preach the word according to the word of God. I thank you even now, God, for all the fivefold ministry, Lord God. When we stand before you, Lord God, let our words be true, Lord God. Let our words bring life, Lord God, to this dying world, Lord God. I thank you right now, God, for your mercy, your grace, your long-suffering, Lord God, that you have stretched out your hand to your people, Lord God. I ask you even now, God, all the sinners, Lord God, that's struggling, Lord God, and tugging, Lord God, that need to be saved. I ask you even now, Lord God, that you would save them even as we pray, Lord God. We know, God, they can't come except you draw. We trust in you. We believe in you, Lord God, that you're going to draw souls into the kingdom, Lord God, as we are witnessing, going in the highways and byways and compelling men and women to come. Lord, I know you're going before us, Lord God, and we praise you even now, Lord God, for the work, Lord God, that you're allowing us to do in Baton Rouge and in Jackson, Lord God. We thank you right now, God, for the doors you open, for the souls you're bringing in, Lord God, for those that just went down in Jesus' name. We ask you even now, God, that they will be filled with the Holy Ghost, God, and able to walk the walk and talk the talk, Lord God, that you have for us to do, God. I ask you even now, Lord God, look on Bishop Daniel, First Lady Daniel, Bishop Brooks, First Lady Brooks, Lord God, meet every need in their lives, oh God. I thank you right now, God, for the PAW, the LDC, Lord God. I thank you, I thank you, I thank you, Lord God, for souls being saved, even in the organizations, oh God. We thank you, Lord God, that it just won't be for a show of form or fashion, Lord God, that souls will be brought into the kingdom, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, Lord God. I thank you, Lord God, as our children, our grandchildren are out for the summer, Lord God. I ask you even now, God, that you'll protect them, that you will keep them, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, that no tragedy will come nigh unto them, God. I thank you, Lord God, in advance, oh God. I give you glory, I give you praise, and I do give you honor. I thank you for all those that's on the prayer request list. I thank you right now, God, for meet every need, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. We pray, Lord God, for Sister Danielle, Lord God. We ask you even now, Lord God, while she's going through her bereavement period, Lord God, work on her mind, work on her soul, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, and all those that are connected with her, Lord God. We ask you, Lord God, that you would save, that you would deliver, that you would set free even now, God. And we thank you for all those that are in the hospital. We trust in you and believe in you, Lord God, that they're coming through with a speedily recovery. In Jesus' name I pray on today. Amen. Then amen. In the hands of Bishop Nixon.
Thank you, Lord.
This won't be my story no more. All right, saints. We appreciate y'all. Thank God for your patience. I thank God for the mother and son.
Thank you, Lord.
The son started, the mother ended it.
Yes, Jesus.
Isn't that wonderful?
Yes, yes. Thank you, Lord.
All right, all right, all right. It's my time to go, saints. You know, I love you and I love you unto life. But my time is up. I appreciate the time that I spent with you all. But before we go, up what?
Thank you, Lord.
What? Lord. Nothing can conquer us. Because we are victorious, saints.
Yes, God. Yes, God.
Yes, we are. Nothing can conquer us. As always, we love you and we love you unto life. Same time tomorrow. In Jesus' name. Amen. When you came out, were those people still yet cutting trees and stuff by Bubba House?